Here outside of Santa Barbara, we came across this unassuming little rock with a plaque, and we were kind of curious. Here by the coast, not far from the Elwood oil fields, this commemorates the very first shelling of mainland USA during the Second World War. At 7:07 on the 23rd of February, just about the time the president was about to speak on the radio, people started hearing thumps, and a Japanese submarine had surfaced and was shelling the oil fields. The oil fields were without military protection. At that time, most installations were, since we all at that time had remembered Pearl Harbor the year before. No one was hurt, no damage was really done, but psychologically, damn, they're shelling our country. Bad. A lot of things started from that. But thank God, no one was hurt on this one.
About a week after the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, submarines of the Japanese 6th Fleet arrived off the coast of America. 9 submarines were then tasked with performing reconnaissance and disrupting the sea lanes. 2 American tankers were sunk and 1 freighter was damaged. Not until February 19, 1942, did submarine I-17 covertly land off Point Loma in California, first to discover her position before sailing up the California coast. 4 days later, she surfaced quietly as dusk fell. At 7:15, Commander Nishino fired the first round towards the Elwood oil fields near Santa Barbara. The I-17 fired around 20 rounds or so from her 14-centimeter 40-deck guns, targeting the Richfield Arco aviation fuel storage tanks behind the beach. The bombardment lasted some 20 minutes, and the closest shell landed in the field just 30 yards from the nearest tank. 1 other shell impacted over a mile inland and some in the water. They all caused only minor damage. The pier, the pump house, some pumping equipment and rigging was also damaged. But just like the previously happily drinking oil workers had now been rushed out of their local bars by explosions, now the U.S. mainland seemed prone to a Japanese attack, and frantic preparations began first to the coastal defenses, and the California State Guard was raised to over 100,000 volunteers. 8 Japanese submarines kept up their hunt until late December 1941. 2 further tankers were sunk and 6 more damaged. Then they returned to Japan to refuel and returned back to the coast of California, with orders initially to torpedo shipping and strike inland targets with their deck guns. This order was later rescinded. However, there's more to this story than just the typical wars and battles. The commander of the I-17, Commander Nishino, he may have had a personal motive to shell the Elwood oil fields. He had been part of a merchant seaman expedition there in the 1930s, and he had visited the oil fields, was welcomed ashore by the local oil executives, and walked with him on shore, but could not contain their laughter as the Japanese commander had slipped and fallen butt first onto a cactus, humiliating him deeply. So it's just possible that he personally wanted to lob a few sails back at the offending cacti. And it made the I-17 the first Axis ship to shell the United States mainland. Also, he did not dive the submarine immediately, as it was still seen on the surface past 8 p.m., and some people saw flashing lights, maybe signaling saboteurs ashore. Or so it was reported, further fueling the panic and the jittery nerves, especially amongst the Los Angeles anti-aircraft gunners, who at one point fired thousands of rounds at either a UFO or an imaginary air threat on February 25th. A radar contact was identified at 2:07 a.m. as an unidentified aircraft approaching Los Angeles. It was called full alert, going through all the gauntlets, expecting the aircraft to be hostile, and searchlights opened up, as did the AA guns at 3:16 at night. All guns opened up, delivering over 48 shells per minute each into the air, and only stopped 20 minutes later, then opened up again at 4:05 for another 10 minutes. Over 1,440 rounds had been thrown up in the air, and many of them had exploded there, whereafter the city had endured a 10-ton rain of metal, down over the ground of unexploded ordnances also, mostly 3-inch shells that had not exploded in the air and rained down where they had to be excavated by the EOD squads over the next following days. Throughout the air raid, 9 people died, although mostly from heart attacks, and no planes were hit, except for American planes in Inglewood, where, again, a rain of metal had fallen on the wings of the planes on the tarmac, damaging many of those. Sadly, however, this did result in a severe treatment of the local Japanese residents, but that is a different story. The investigation of what actually happened ended up in the congressional hearing, and the Army really did not want to admit that they had reacted to a false alarm. Many of the gunners also swore they had seen planes, balloons, or, actually, some suggested a spacecraft. Now, back to the Japanese U-boats, though. There was also the night of June 21, 1942. Japanese submarine I-25 surfaced at the mouth of the Columbia River in Oregon. With her deck guns, the I-25 fired some 17 to 20 shells at the coastal artillery installation at Fort Stevens. Although the bombardment caused no damage to the base itself, it did destroy the backstop of the base's baseball field. The attack by the I-25 made Fort Stevens the first continental United States military installation to come under enemy fire during the Second World War, the first time this had happened since the War of 1812. And the third time, on August 15, 1942, the I-25 left Yokosuna to make what would be the final Japanese attack on the American coast. It was a reprisal, although a small one, to the Doolittle raid on Tokyo in April that year. On September 9th, I-25 launched the E-14Y Glenn, a seaplane, piloted by Warrant Flying Officer Nobu Fujita. The plane dropped 2 76-kilogram incendiary bombs on a forest near Brookings in Oregon. Though the mission was meant to trigger wildfires, but the typical wet Pacific Northwest weather kept the fire from spreading. The attack remained the only time an enemy aircraft had bombed mainland United States, and both submarines were lost in August 1943. Despite the psychological impact of these attacks, the value of the submarines were heavily discounted in the Japanese Navy, lacking proper doctrine. The Japanese submarine campaign was far less effective than either the German or the American campaigns of the Second World War. A little bit down from where the memorial was, find this little gem of architecture. This little cool little gas station built in 1925. William Randall Hearst used to visit this gas station on his way into LA. It just narrowly survived the shelling from the submarine. But in 1950, the one highway was rerouted. This was closed, not to open again. But this little colonial gem survived war, survived a lot of things. The locals are hoping it's going to reopen, and because it's a beautiful building, I'm sensing a restaurant. Maybe I can get some damn crepes in there.
When you're driving through a great country like America, you'll come by so many different interesting places. And guess what? If you have your face stuck in your phone, trying to figure out what somebody you don't really know is writing about something you really don't care about, you're going to miss all these interesting places, like the gas station or the historical site here. And that's why we put our phone down and we keep our eye glued out the windows as we drive through our beautiful country here and see the sights. So let's go see some more.